Hi, welcome to JSFU. So JSFU is my favorite. It's my annual thing that it's our party. We get together, talk about code, functional programming, diss the Java guys. So as always, I'd like to start by thanking Hasgeek for giving us this opportunity, this great venue with the bright lights today. So thank you, Hasgeek. One more JSFU in the bag. Hopefully it goes as well as all the previous ones. Thank you very much. So this is a version of a talk that I gave like at JSFU Pune. So at that point of time, JSFU was held in classrooms, and we all had to shuffle into a little cafeteria room to have a buffet lunch, and that was great. At the time, I just joined Yahoo after being fired from my previous job, and totally, like, I got fired. I don't know why. I was like, sure. And at that point of time, the JavaScript wave had like broken. Like, it was mainstream. People were using Backbone, and people were learning how to use HTML5 push-pull. So that video has like a bunch of, I don't know, like it's 400 views, like awesome in the JavaScript scale, considering there are about like 400 people here right now. Anyway, so that was interesting for me because at that point I was like, okay, fine, we are ditching the toy language thing. We are saying serious language. We are building applications with it. And it went well. So I did a bunch of talks after that. And I was thinking that, so I was watching it again and I realized that a lot of it is now essentially obsolete. No one even talks, like YUI just went RIP. They're moving to React and stuff like that. Anyway, so the general rule of sequels is that sequels suck. So if I come up here and try to do the same thing that I did last time, it's falling flat. Like a bunch of you are probably like scrolling through, oh, already know what packages I want to talk about and stuff like that. And that's the case with a lot of movies, like Matrix 2 sucked, Matrix 3 sucked, Die Hard 2 sucked. There are some times when sequels don't suck. And there are some characteristics to these movies. The one that I specifically want to talk about is the reason that I'm calling it Amplify or Stack Deux. So if you guys have seen Hot Shots Part Deux, right? Remember this, right? Charlie Sheen went without any drug wrinkles. Interesting days. So it's awesome. It's slapstick, physical comedy, just like a Leslie Nielsen movie. The thing about the movie is that they never break character. Not like the Big Bang Theory, like there's no laugh track or nothing like that. They're doing all these gags, but they're serious about it. He really thinks he's in Rambo, and he shoots a chicken at a guy with his bow and arrow, and he kills the dude. I think he shoots it at his butt or something. It was an excellent movie. So the point of sequels is that you have to like find out what your roots are and actually like compress it down to just those things. People are looking for a core experience. Captain America 2 had a lot more punching because people like punching. So, excellent. So I've been up to stuff. The last time I was up here, I was saying that I was going to be at Yahoo for many years. I'm with Myntra now. And I work there as an architect, and we build solutions to business problems. And that makes it sound like way fancier than it actually is. What happens is the bosses decide how we want to build this, we want to do this. Me and a bunch of old people, we sit together and say, okay, what is the least amount of work that we can do to get the most amount of impact? Move forward to the next feature, the next project. And it works fine. Like, it's a great strategy. Like, let's see what we can do, how fast we can do it. So it's an interesting team. Okay, so disclaimer, right? So Myntra is apparently a sponsor, so I'm not supposed to do a pitch type thing. Like, I can't really tell you 35% off. So I will make fun of Myntra once, and then I'll stop talking about Myntra, okay? So here it is. I'm probably live cast, so there's probably somebody at office watching this right now. That is the weirdest brand name ever. I don't know what it means. My dad doesn't know how to pronounce it yet. He keeps saying Myntra. It's in Myntra. Is it Mantra? So legend has it that our CEO picked it because he didn't get Mantra.com, and he didn't expect it to be a billion-dollar company someday. But that is, I don't get it, but you know, the logo is kind of nice, so I deal with it. Anyway, so my first draft for this talk like started really badly. So I took A4 sheets, and I started writing down concepts like automation scripts and less frameworks and module systems and stuff like that. And it was like really ridiculous. So I want to show you this one slide from something Kanga shared on Twitter. Okay, not sure if you can see it clearly, but I'll read it out. Like, there's stuff for scaffolding, building automation, automation utilities, and I don't know the difference. Really, there's dependency management and dynamic loading and preprocessors and libraries and test runners and DOM utilities. And this is just the JavaScript part of it. Then you have to talk about like CSS and what you're doing for your static assets and what you're doing like as a framework as a whole to like, because there are going to be 20 people working on your stack or whatever. How are you delivering your HTML? What is your YSLO score? Oh my God, SEO. And do you have a library helper for that? What about isomorphic rendering? How are you doing single page app? This can't be the way forward. I was really looking forward to doing that, by the way. pulling out 10 packages and saying, guys, this is the way forward. You should, and you totally should learn React.js and Swift and all that jazz, but it doesn't, I can't really talk to you for, it'll take me a couple of weeks to go through all of them. And that's the nature of the JavaScript community. Like, they're very, like, experimental and do 20 things and all that. So, okay, fine. Let's look at a slightly easier way to do this. We'll start with the basics, right? So, what are the basics? What exactly is it that we do all day? We call it programming. Need something better. Like, programming is what comes on TV channels. Like, Friends coming from 8 to 8:30 is programming by the TV network. So, a bunch of people say that, like, oh, it's making machine stuff and all that, but I think it's like one very specific thing, that you write code that replaces humans or human behavior. It shouldn't require humans anymore. So, it sounds very bombastic, but let me tell you what I mean, right? Okay, so in the 90s, this is how you bought shoes. I just Googled shoe store and I copied one image. I don't know copyright and all, very sorry. But okay, so you went into a shoe store and you asked a guy, hey, I like red shoes. So will you show me some red shoes and maybe leather in a size 8? And he goes inside a thing and he comes back with something that's not red shoes. And you're like, dude, I just said red shoes. He's like, oh, sorry, he goes back and figures it out. And so now this entire thing, this entire process where you had to pay money to go to commercial street and buy shoes is essentially replaced by one line of code. And this is the line of code from Mintra's code base, okay? Where we have a bunch of services. You say search, you give it a query term. You can pass it parameters like size 8 and stuff like that. The results come to a callback. I have ruined the lives of this poor shoe salesman with just this. Now, it takes a bunch of work to get here. Like, a solar cluster has been set up, and they've set up APIs on it, and it can scale so that, like, when traffic comes, like, it can scale upwards and all that jazz. But essentially, this is what we were working towards, where I can talk to my machine that I've built and say, hey, show me all the red shoes we have, and then, like, filter down upon it. Filter node. So, yeah, that's the deal. Like, write code that replaces humans or, like, human interaction. That's why they have like robots and drones and stuff like that. That's always the goal, to make a lot of people unemployed, I guess. Anyway, and for JavaScripters, then there's this concept of like front-end development. Okay, so that's one thing, right? JavaScript is essentially the language for front-end development. Now close contenders are, of course, Android and iOS. And you know what? Some of it is nice. If you guys have been messing with Swift, seen a bunch of things, but what does it mean to us? What does the word front-end development mean to us? What is the difference between you and the guy who's writing Java services? Well, it's that you're actually defining the interface between the human and the machine at that moment, right? You are at that moment where you're getting unpredictable input. You don't know what the guy is going to type and click and all that. If you have services, you can throw error conditions, but you can't tell your user, you know, bugger off just because he spelled the word shoes wrong. And he wants a nice interface into your machine. He can't use this, obviously. What he'd like is this. So the original Google didn't have a submit button because those guys were engineers and they just used to keep pressing enter. And I like that. You just type red shoes and you spit me back a bunch of products. So, awesome. Front-end development is also one of our things in the JavaScript world. Let me talk about what platform is. This has been a changing answer, but now the answer is settled, okay? It used to be writing little stuff inside your browser to do drop-downs and hover effects and all that jazz. And then it was like, oh, Ajax, so I'm going to start doing service calls from the browser. Now JavaScript on server also, so you can do your own service things. Essentially, you're talking to clients and servers. You're creating clients and servers at this moment as a JavaScript developer. Or as a developer of any sort having to do with anything with the internet. But then that doesn't make sense because you have like robots with JavaScript. You have people writing natural language processing algorithms with JavaScript, video games with JavaScript. So this entire slide is useless. I'm sorry, I wasted 2 minutes of your time. Programming is everything. It's not about client, servers, little thing. You just look at a problem and say, how do I make... You guys remember switchboards of the 40s and 50s? Like in the black and white movies, there used to be these women in skirts who used to sit and connect you and say, excuse me, sir, I'm just connecting you to the guy. Like, we killed that job. I want to be very serious about it. We ruined that industry. They were very happy and taking a salary back, and we wrote software and we kind of left them unemployed. Then again, of course, computers have lifted humanity up. I'm not being that serious, guys. Relax. Then there's the concept of theory. Okay, how much effort should you put into learning how to write code? Not with what tools to write code. Anybody can give you a bloody API design list and say, __map_reduce, all that jazz. But who tells you that that code should be constructed in a particular way? Have you sat down and thought about it? There's this nice concept that I like called Schumpeterianism. It means like creative destruction. Like, I'm not really attached to the final product of what I wanted it to be. I'm happy breaking it down 5 more times and seeing where I can reach with it. It's just a Git repo. I can keep it running, but I'm always looking to like break it down. So theory is important. And at that level, you can learn about like design patterns. You can learn about books. You can use books. You can sit down with somebody who you respect in your office and ask them questions. There's a quote that I keep coming back to, and it's by John Carmack, this guy who wrote Doom, Wolf 3D. Somebody's played Doom in this room, right? Really? Okay, thank you. One guy's played Doom in this room. 2, 3, 4, 5. Yeah, okay, fine. You get it. You guys played Doom. Sorry. Anyway, so the code is pretty simple. Sometimes the elegant implementation is just a function, not a method, not a class, not a framework, just a function. And you ask yourself, like, why? This isn't just like lip service to like functional programming, because the dude has been writing video games. He wasn't really using hardcore functional programming languages. But the idea is that the function is the easiest way to express a verb, a unit of human thought, right? You'll pass some arguments to it, and you'll process it, and you'll return something else out. And at the end of the day, that's what most of our job is. You're picking data up from a bunch of places, doing a bunch of stuff to it, and either passing it on or putting it to a browser or to an iOS app or an Android app. So in essence, like everything is modeled after one of these functions, so you should be able to like twist them around and do a bunch of stuff. So there's a lot of theory behind functions, and you're encouraged to actually go out and do it, to read about it, because these are things that like model the way your brain starts solving problems. And it's always interesting to learn something new. So I remember doing a talk, and I have no evidence that this ever happened, but I remember doing a talk on the principles of object-oriented programming languages, object-oriented programming. And so Rakesh is looking at me, and he's like, dude, like I have very little respect for you. Why did you do this? It's because I could have that one slide up front which said principles of object-oriented programming, and it just spelled poop. So that's cool. Flat. Then the idea of tests. This is something that I spoke about during my last talk. And the idea is simple, okay? You ask yourself, how do you write interfaces? How do you write HTML and CSS? You have a working relationship with your designer, and he comes up to you with like a Photoshop that he spent 2 weeks on, right? And it looks like the site, but you can't really click it. So what you do, you keep it to the left, you open up Sublime Text or whatever on the right, and you start writing code. And at every point of time, you're refreshing the browser and comparing it to the JPG and saying, okay, fine. Like, this is how it's coming along. So don't you, and that it would be strange if you didn't have a mock at that time, like if you didn't have a PRD, because you'd be building something, but you're not sure if it's actually what everyone wants. This provides a reference. It looks very much like the website, but it doesn't work at all, but it provides that reference. So the idea with tests, and I'm not talking about unit tests, I'm not talking about integration tests or feature tests or whatever. Basically, some amount of code that you write and make sure that your program works. So those kinds of tests. So the phrase that I repeat again is something that my mentor told me before. So it's like Photoshop for code. All you have to do is write down a list of things that you expect your program to do in some form of code. Now you could be using Mocha, you could be using, QUnit or a whole bunch of unit testing frameworks or just a regular bash script or something you've spun up with Node. You can do all of that. But the general question is, do you have a reference point that you know your code is getting towards? Now it doesn't really have to work, the spec. But it does have to have, like, it should be able to run tests on the code that you're writing and keep going green, 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 green. Fair? Okay. All right. So the general form of a test, again, copy-pasted essentially from my last time, you should be able to write something like this based on your machine. Okay? You have a machine. It's a noun called machine. It could be an app.app instance, or it could be a router instance, or a controller, or whatever. You have a machine, and you say, machine, do something, and tell me what it is. And let's say that you're building an adder, right? It adds two numbers. So you give it like 2 and 2, and you get back the result. And you make sure that it's 4. If it's not 4, alarm bells. Else, carry on. That's it. It's as simple as that. So like you look back at your applications that you're working on right now, whether front end or back end or whatever. What is the least amount of work that you can do to say, okay, it works as expected. I can run this on 4 browsers and it'll do the same thing. So yes, tests. I'm not even saying unit tests anymore. Even I've given up on writing unit tests. I don't have the time for it. But I definitely write like a small bunch of things that just run my machine and make sure it's doing what is expected. 3 months later, when a whole other bunch of people are working on the code base and break it, that'd be the thing that saves your ass. Awesome. Libraries. Favorite thing to quarrel about online right now is what is a library, what is a framework. I think I got like some kind of answer. Okay. So when I'm building an application, or any of you are building an application, your concepts in the application. So you don't really say database, you'll say like data store, okay? So I have something where I store all my data. And I'll be doing network calls, either via AJAX or via network, HTTP, so on and so forth. Or I want to do, I want a little library that deals with DOM elements. Okay? So a library is something that basically enables this for you in the language of your choosing. Okay, so if you want to do functional programming, you can pick up underscore JS or load as JS or whatever it is. But once you have that in your stack, you can now do functional programming with your arrays and your objects and so on. Similarly, you can pick something like super agent just for doing network calls. So it uses AJAX on the front end. It's isomorphic. So it works on the back end and you can make calls from there as well. So the basic point I'm trying to make here is that you have to choose your libraries for concepts and not for hype. Awesome, a whole bunch of people love jQuery, I get that, and it solves a number of problems for you. But the next moment that the only reason you pull jQuery into your... Everybody's hating on jQuery nowadays. I'm sorry, I don't mean to pick on jQuery, but the idea is that just because you needed AJAX, like a basic concept of XML HTTP request for one thing, you know, it added 35K of weight, and you're basically pulled concepts that you didn't really want from a library itself. Instead, look at something a lot smaller. The ecosystem is huge. Like I just showed in the beginning, you will find something that you want if you don't write your own and publish it on NPM. But yes, libraries choose for concepts and not for hype. The next slide is very specifically, it's like it doesn't sound right, okay? You have to think about what your motivations and values are for writing the software, okay? Not so much in a, like, I'm passionate about JavaScript and stuff like that, okay, no. But you tell your, like, for example, in Mintra, we say, okay, least amount of work for most amount of impact. What is it that we can do? We'll build systems for 50 million people once we actually have 50 million traffic. For now, let's get 400 people onto the thing and see if they like the product. So those are our motivations, to be able to get stuff out to our customers, like, really quickly. At Yahoo, like, we, our motivations were about getting great technical scores on our pages, like Weislow would give AAAAA, and those were just the things that we were asked to attempt anyway. So if you have these base thoughts set down, hey, we are maybe a functional programming team, we don't really want to sit and model the entire, well, architecture of the company in JavaScript, we'll just have little values and we'll pass it through pipes and we'll go ahead. Or you ask yourself whether you're building a system for 2 million people out the gate. Maybe you are. Maybe you're building a mass push notification platform and stuff like that. But unless you actually think deeply about how we are going to be building these things very early, what will happen is that 5 people with different opinions will build some stuff a little, again, a little differently, and you might be okay with that. But it's nice to have everyone pointing in the same direction, if anything, like for rhythm. Cool. Motivations and values. Then we get to frameworks. Okay. No flame fest. Very simple. I think I have a definition for frameworks as well. What do frameworks do? What is it that is common between Ember and Angular and ext.js, but not so much react.js? So frameworks basically try to codify a style of thought. This goes back to the whole motivation values that I talk about. The people who are best at writing ext.js were the guys who made it. Similarly, Facebook writes awesome react.js code because they just made it. They think very deeply about how they want to solve a problem, and because they want other people to solve the problem in the same way they thought about it, they try to put it, like, establish it in code. So if you use Angular, then you have to learn about transclusion and a bunch dependency injection and how they do└└└└└└└└└└└└└└└└└└└└└└└└└└└└└└└└└└└└└└└└└└└└└└└└└└└└└└└└└└└└└└└└└└└└└└└└└└└└└└└└└└װ└└└└└└└└└If you're doing Ember, it's doing a whole bunch of data binding on elements directly. Sure, whatever it is. But if you're going for it, either you buy into it completely or you are just wasting your time, I have to say. Because I know a lot of people who say, no, no framework for me. You're going to go back and you're going to set up your code in a particular way. That, my friend, is your framework. You have decided that I'm going to be building code in this fashion and I've made a folder for it. Awesome. So, as an example, I'd like to tell you what my framework for code right now is, like what my machines I think they do, what the flow structure is. It's actually like, it's influenced by the Flux architecture from Facebook, but this is my version of it, okay? So I have links in my machine. This is the API. It could look like an Ahref, it could look like a button, it could be a form submit, it could be whatever. So I have either humans interacting with it, or recently with WebSockets and all, I have like servers interacting with my browser as well. Fine. So, like, there are basic entry points that I can click on my application. And then after that, my application does some stuff with the data store, and then renders it to the screen and changes the button color. And so if you click, for example, one tab, that's a human who just hit one of my tab links. And then I check to see what the active tab was, and maybe I should toggle it. Then I save the state of what the active tab now is, and then I update it to show what the DOM is. It sounded really bad, but you get what I mean. Like, I basically look at machines now like this, like little interaction machines, and then like they come all the way back just by clicking or so on and so forth. So it's like unidirectional. So I have a little image of how the flux architecture is, if you can actually see it. So the language that they use is actions. So every machine has actions, button click and hover and type in an input field and so on. So you have actions which fire it onto a dispatcher for a machine. This machine goes and updates a whole bunch of data stores, and then it spits it down and renders the view. Further things have to come up via an action itself. It's interesting because otherwise MVC is claimed to be the slightly tightly bound thing, and after a point of time, it's hard to maintain those relationships. But this is more like server-side programming, right? Like, you take a bunch of data, construct HTML, give it to him. The next guy, he clicks a link, it's going to come all the way back up. Feel free to investigate that. And finally, the one that is near and dear to my heart, so to speak, is automation. So automation is the ultimate level of programming, where you end up automating yourself. So there are a bunch of things that you do. Okay, fine, like you have build scripts and all that jazz. But your project doesn't end the day that you actually finish writing code for it. It goes up on a production machine, and then there are going to be ops guys who talk to it, and there are going to be QA guys who want to do some tests on another machine with it and stuff like that. So you don't want them to have to come to you every time they want to deploy it on another machine, or so, like at least a readme.md. So to share, for example, exactly what I mean, I have a list of what our make actions are inside the Mintra search page, the way that we do this. So we have something that sets it up, so a developer comes inside, he sits down, clones the thing, runs make setup, and it sets the whole thing up for him. You can do like, it starts up a little development server, so and every time you edit a jail, it restarts itself. Update like updates all your dependencies and package.json because it's a node thing. So it compiles templates, generates bundles, lints the thing, which is useful for us because a bunch of people don't put semicolons at the end or whatever. Upload files to CDN, and we have like a key somewhere that it pulls. Generate documentation for the thing. I think that's a to-do that I might have removed. Then it runs all our tests on the thing. And so these are all the things that would be actions that I would be doing by hand. So I want to now write code that automates that for myself, that automates myself. So the next time that these guys want to run tests on a production server, they just run a little thing like that runs a script of mine. And essentially that's it, okay? If you have these base concepts in place, that you have thought about what code is going to be once it's starts leaving your fingers and then finally leaves your machine, and you actually go through a little bit of diligence, then this starts looking a little simpler. They're essentially trying to solve one problem each, and you don't really have to solve a bunch of problems until you, like, for example, bump into it. So, for example, if you're doing a single page app, and you don't really need like routing and stuff like that, don't put page.js in the beginning. Don't tell yourself, I'm going to choose these 10 things, because it'll just be available. That is just one line away. You start looking at it and you're like, okay, fine. Something like Clojure script, it might be interesting for me as an experiment, but I'm not putting it into production yet. So I'll take that off the table. I won't even think about that as an option when I'm thinking about it for work. Something like writing tests. Okay, fine, hold on. I don't really have all that time to write unit tests. Ideally, you should. You look for coverage. But I should be able to pick a couple of these things and run automated tests on my machines. Awesome. Boss happy, product manager happy, QA guys super happy. And yeah, so essentially that, like, ask yourself what you're doing at work. You're writing little machines that replaced human work, but you're trying to enable human beings to do a lot more. And that's the punchline to the entire thing, right? Because we could do this people are happier, they're able to get stuff delivered to their house and stuff like that. And that's important, I think. Like, that is how the world has been progressing. Like, computers evolve way faster than human beings, but they're taking us along for the ride. As long as we do it with diligence, I think we should be fine. Questions? I'm sorry I bored all of you guys. Okay? No questions? Okay, awesome. Thanks a lot, guys. Enjoy JS4. I promise the others are way funnier than mine. Yeah. Oh, okay.
You didn't talk about what stuff you use. I mean, for instance, in each of those steps.
Oh, sure.
In your work.
Sure. You want me just quickly go back and tell you some of the modules I'm using? So this is just Make. It's a 1977 program. And this runs little Node scripts. So a lot of it is written in Node for me. I use underscore for functional programming. I'm really looking forward to what React is bringing to the table. Have you people messed with React.js? Anybody go to the workshop yesterday? Phenomenal stack. It's interesting because it lets you keep rendering to the page in a very performant way, so you don't have to write the same code twice. I like little functions that return objects. I like Super Agent because it's an isomorphic library. That means that as long as I proxy my services down to the browser, I can write code that works in the browser and the server for free. It just works. You can switch off JavaScript and the thing keeps working again. I like Mocha for testing. Very clean API. I like reading John Carmack's Twitter feed. That's nice. I think I got this off Bootstrap. This is styling. So Bootstrap is quite heavy, but you can also check out Yahoo's Pure CSS. That's quite nice. It's really small, 4K. Nice. I am a human that talks to a machine. And these are just APIs built with Super Agent and underscore. Very few tools. But we are having a lot of fun just keeping it down to that much right now. Okay. Any more questions?
What is the code testing framework for you like? I mean, what do you use for testing?
So I like Mocha basically and should.js, but not because I love it or anything. It just it's very simple to say, take a function and here's a callback that you can call when you're done with your test, instead of having to do spies and stuff like that. Further, I used to do a lot of mocking for my tests, fake data, but now I just talk to the real services. It makes the tests run a little longer, but it's fine really. 10 seconds is fine compared to 2 seconds. I'm already surfing Reddit anyway in another window by then. But yeah, Mocha is nice. You can check out Mocha and should. I think there's a group that you get something called chai.js. You might want to Google that as well. Any other library recommendations that I can do for you?
Different question. So when you build your own frameworks, which is what you end up doing, your own way of coding, you sort of become less nimble because you get sort of attached to it. So how do you, what's your pattern of reusing modules others have written versus stuff you write yourself?
Okay, so I'm not the best at this, but I'll tell you some of the things that we do to keep it simple, okay? So first of all, there's not I've stopped doing these inheritance classes, a person, animal, that sort of thing. No, functions that return objects, and ideally stuff that doesn't mutate the object back. So when I say object, I don't mean a new instance of a class that I defined, though we use that as well. But I'm more interested in stuff like arrays with regular values in it. Instead of having an instance of a person class, I'm much happier having a hash which says name is equal to so on. And so once I keep it that lightweight, it's very easy to switch it out because all then you're doing is data transformation. You're not really worried about class inheritances and stuff like that. Further, functional programming if I can do stuff with a simple map reduce kind of thing, then happy. Because that means that since I've described it with verbs and I know that my requirements I get with in verbs, I can change the code also then fairly simply. Otherwise I'd have to think about which guys are talking to which guys and how it's evented and stuff like that. So
but let's say you're working in a team, mm-hmm. and you have your own style of code.
Sure.
So how do you impose that on others, or what do you do?
So I implement their features before they get to it. okay, so this is the way that is. No, I'm joking, of course. So we argue a lot, as you can imagine. People are fairly opinionated around me at work, and that's good. And I've learned that consensus does not have to mean compromise. We try out both things. We put A/B test on it. We see a number. We can argue about commas and all, but they're frankly, I think we've moved past that. We just want to get stuff done. There's a lot of shit to do inside the place. Okay, all right.
There is a question.
Sorry.
How do you guys test memory leaks in the production?
Memory leaks.
So if something is lagging.
So there's a lot of prayer involved. I'm crying inside. So this is what we do, okay? thankfully, because at the scale that we are at, we can throw traffic at a server, okay, if we want to. That means if we leave something running and it has a memory leak, we will start seeing our New Relic graphs like going up, RAM usage and stuff like that. We'll start seeing that weird graph and eventually like it'll die and it'll start up again. At that point of time, we go back and see who broke what suddenly. Like we go through every commit and we can do this. So because like little node packages and we use like Git for our deploys are really short. Like it really goes there, spins up the machine again. And like if it's just like one file delta, it's about 10 seconds to do the thing. So we can actually try out live versions. I'm sorry if it's affected anyone's shopping experience so far, but we can theoretically do this. And we've done it a couple of times. Further, we have like, we run profiling and stuff like that. That being said, we don't even have a lot of this evented stuff. Like memory leaks have turned out to be fairly rare now that we have moved to this functional way of just moving data down chains. Very few references are kept upwards and so on, except like when we're doing caches, but we have like flushes on those caches. Does that answer your question?
Somewhat. Somewhat.
So we pray is what I'm saying.
Excuse me?
Yeah.
Hi. Yeah. What is your take on isomorphic JavaScript? Because we are talking about stack.
It's awesome. I love writing isomorphic. I like that it has a cool name, like isomorphic. It sounds like a cartoon from the 90s. Isomorphic. Point being, no, it's okay. So conceptually, you know, whether you're writing code for the browser or the server, this is basically what you do. You talk to a bunch of places, one session service, one data service, one configuration service. You take that data together, you stitch it, and you pass it on to somebody. Now, this could be a template that spits out HTML, or it could be a service that spits out JSON, or a protocol buffer, or whatever. So at that level, I'm happy imposing those kinds of abstractions over it. So for that, which is why I recommend SuperAgent as an Ajax library to use, because it gives a uniform API across Node and the browser. And on the browser, the only change that I make is I remove the domain name because like no cross-domain Ajax and we proxy down to regular services. So at that level, then the rest is just like JavaScript. We have functions that return HTML, whether it runs on the front-end or the back. So we have a little extra code, of course, on the front-end for event handlers and stuff like that. But isomorphic JavaScript, it means less JavaScript. That, I like that. Did that answer your question? Isomorphic. Isomorph. Okay, cool. Hey, thanks a lot, guys. Okay, have fun with JSFoo. Come by and ask questions if you want to.
Hey, Sunil, so you should probably join the scrollback chat room and probably answer a few more questions. Harish. No, there could be. I mean, as people reflect on what you just spoke, if people have questions, it'll be nice if you could answer them, yeah. Well, thank you, Sunil. Guys, one more time, Sunil Pai.